I'd like to now discuss some more general issues.
Yes.
In the time that remains, perhaps if we could start off by what seemed to me to be the general criticism of your work. I mean, putting this in the context of that it seems to me as a little bit more distance from your work that in fact it's been, of course, wonderfully well received, and the criticism's just a sort of very small part, actually, of the influence and esteem in which
you think my separation of law and morality is
What I think interests me as somebody working on legal education,
yes,
and looking at the relationship between the law and the social sciences, is this, that there seem to be three strands of the criticism of the kind of legal philosophy that you are associated with and that you have espoused. And they are, first of all, the problem of the enterprise of analytical philosophy itself, that it's that there's too much of the taken for granted about it, that it has been argued by some that those who have worked within analytical philosophy treat it as self-evidently good, that it's more appropriate to the clarification of particular concepts, that it's better, in other words, at the micro level rather than at the macro level, that it's not very good in terms of building theory. And this tendency is exemplified...
I say that myself in the introduction to my essays on philosophy and literature. Mm-hmm. There are lots of questions which can't be solved by asking, even with utmost sensitivity to the type of answer to given, asking about the meaning of the concepts. That's where there's fundamental disagreement, which inspires diverse views of what law is and so on. And you've got to get at the fundamental disagreement.
So there are clear limits to your mind to...
Yes.
Where analytical...
It's the beginning, not the end. The answer.
But it's the beginning, so it has a certain primacy.
Yes.
Over other approaches to...
Yes, I think if you plunge into sociology straight along without asking what a society is and so on, which is not entirely, but it's partly a verbal question, a question of analysis, you get into trouble.
One aspect of this, of being committed to analytical philosophy, it's been argued, is that it's suspicious of programmes, grand theory. In some ways, this is associated with people like Wisdom. Do you think that's true?
It's suspicious of grand theory if it comes along too soon and obscures radical distinctions of very great importance. But if anybody could produce a grand theory, analytical theory isn't as hostile to grand theory. I mean, this is not law, but Austin himself, who was in many ways thought of, J.L. Austin, thought of an extreme analytical ordinary language philosopher, at the end of his life produced a vast theory of speech acts, characterizing the different forms of thought and discourse, that they were compatible or not. And so it isn't. I mean, he produced the speech act theory, which is a large scale theory.
Right.
I don't know what to say. I'd look at any theory with respect and try and evaluate it by the appropriate criteria, which wouldn't be confined to the analytical distinctions made by an analytical philosophy.
I agree. Another general criticism that's made of, I suppose it's the dominance, the continuing dominance of the analytical tradition in English jurisprudence, is the argument that it's tended to reinforce, albeit perhaps unconsciously, the unsociological, unhistorical, relatively uncontextual law as autonomous and apolitical tradition within legal scholarship generally.
Yes.
That law is legal education is about turning out lawyers.
Yes, and my work certainly is open to that, I think, to some extent. I wrote that book, Hans of Law, very much with lawyers in mind, and for them. I do make the remark, which drives people mad with anger.
But it being descriptive, descriptive sociology.
What I should have said is that it provides the tools for descriptive sociology, not that it is descriptive sociology.
I was going to ask you about that. What did you mean, by this? It was an essay in descriptive sociology.
I meant that if you read that book, you would see that we need to discriminate various types of situations, say, where people habitually follow somebody, where they accept him, that's one thing, where they accept him as their guide to conduct, and therefore his word is a reason for acting, or as a guide to the criticism of other people's conduct. And then a third idea where they accept him as in some way motherly, legitimated.
Yes.
Well, these are all distinctions that come out of my kind of analytical philosophy. And I thought those are absolutely vital for one to do sociology.
Because there isn't a sustained attention to notions like society or the state or so on in your work, is there? I mean, that's one of the ways in which it differs from...
Somewhere I've written about the state. Where is it?
So there is this criticism then of the analytical, the dominance of the analytical tradition, as it were, legitimating the black letter tradition, as it's been called, the law is autonomous.
There's not much black letter in language.
But you don't see that then as
I have some kind of sympathy with this. That a richer background produced more frontally would be useful to people and might discourage certain ideas that a law was a closed system of its own. But by the time I talked about open texture and the need for discretion, it becomes very difficult to say it is a closed system.
Yes, yes. I wondered whether the concern, not this jewel of grand theory of metaphysics in the continental sense, to what extent that's related to the concern in the 1930s, 40s and 50s with continental metaphysics as being dangerous, the argument that people like Plato, Hegel, and Marx, as it were, sowed the seeds of fascism, the kind of Popperian argument in open society and its enemies.
No problem at all.
So a suspicion of grand theory or the need to keep it, you don't feel that your work is like other analytical philosophy?
Yeah, good luck to it if you can produce some good grand theory. It's very difficult.
One interpretation of the dominance of the analytical tradition and its caution towards continental philosophy and metaphysics and so on is that particularly with the rise of fascism in the 30s and 40s that positivism, analytical philosophy were seen as being part of the democratic bulwark that held back the dangers of continental metaphysics. Is that sort of guaranteed notions of liberty and freedom?
I see. The analytical philosophy was a defence.
That's right.
It punctured, insofar as claims that the state was really enforcing the real will of its citizens, and therefore they must obey, and they're only obeying themselves, which is in Rousseau and is a travesty perhaps of Hegel, but is it in there? I think to be brought up in the animal condition might make you healthily immune from this.
And do you think...
find that in the essay on Birdman.
Right, and you think that's actually quite desirable, that one should be?
Yes, make you suspicious.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And I suppose with this goes the fact that you, by and large, haven't paid much attention to sociological theories. You mentioned earlier...
I'm probably very guilty, yes. I find sociological books difficult to read. I did read through Stern.
Mm-hmm.
Well, maybe Stern, I think. I have read the Scandinavian people to some extent. Lundstedt, who is a sociologist of sort.
What do you understand by the sociologist's concerns?
Oh, to produce generalizations about the structure and the development and decay of societies. And to produce generalizations in this field, I became very cautious about generalizations.
Mm-hmm. And why that caution? Because of coming out of the English analytical tradition?
No, because the implications are so enormous and the data look so tenuous.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Just ordinary empirical caution.
Mm-hmm. And yet you've not actually done any work on how the law operates in practice, not actually taken that particular empirical road.
What about capital punishment?
Mm. Mm. What about more recent legal scholarship? I suppose since the 1960s we've seen critical legal studies, law in context, sociology of law. Do you read that work? Does it engage you?
I'd rather concentrate on trying to get out this reply to my critics.
Do you think that kind of trend within legal scholarship and legal education is desirable?
The critical realism seems to me to be just like the exaggerated form of the old legal realism. Yeah. I mean, less respectable.